In today's episode, I speak to Aruna Jelly Maria about driving business results through storytelling. Leaders should be authentic and consider the future human skills that are necessary to drive business results, like neurocoupling. Humans are wired to remember stories, especially those that come from real lived experiences. Listen up to the rest of the conversation.
Hey there, my name's David Chislett, and I write for the Maverick Paradox magazine because I am the weapon of mass creation. And Maverick leadership and Maverick skills are very hard to separate from being creative, thinking outside the box, coming up with new solutions. So I contribute to the magazine talking about the skills and the approaches which will enhance your creativity, which will enable you to behave more like a Maverick leader by helping you break out of the confines of the box.
Welcome to the Maverick Paradox podcast, where we explore what it is to be a maverick and discover effective modes of leadership. I am Judith Germain, and my mission is to propel the maverick mindset into a world where character and integrity will ultimately have a higher premium than personality and bureaucracy. So thank you for joining me on this journey. If you would like to continue with me, then please subscribe to my podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, or one of the other popular podcast platforms. That's right, yeah?
Yes. I'll be ready?
In a moment. So the intro and outro are pre-recorded, except for the end, I've just got a paragraph that I say to save me editing that in, okay?
Sorry, could you repeat that?
The intro and outro are pre-recorded, but I've got a paragraph at the end that I say. Right, so are you set?
I'm ready.
Okay. And today our guest is Aruna Jelly Maria. Hiya, how are you doing?
Hi, Ju. Thank you for inviting me. Very excited about our conversation today.
Thank you. Yes, I'm looking forward to it too. So before we begin, though, who are you?
Jude, I'm originally from India, and for the last 8 years, I have been living in Hong Kong. That's home now. I see myself as a jack of many trades, or should I say Jacqueline. I grew up in a typical hardworking, loving middle-class family. And we would be transferred frequently across India. As you may know, in India, Jude, no two states speak the same language, eat the same food, and culturally are very distinct from each other. I have changed over 10 schools, and I would love that. The excitement was around making new friends from diverse backgrounds. And thank you for asking me this, because, you know, as I am reflecting, why am I so excited to meet different clients across different geographies? I think this would have been perhaps where it is rooted. Also, because both my parents were working, my mother's a doctor, dad sold typewriters. Every summer break, I would indulge myself in something new and exciting to learn. So one holiday, it would be painting, next would be sewing, baking, typing, photography, etc. And till date, I'm always in this, I think, learning mode, if I can use that. And that's a phase of life that excites me most, exploring, learning. And again, I think, you know, as an entrepreneur in this phase of my life, it really serves me well, running a learning consulting company. On the professional side, I started working for a multinational bank, engaged in different roles, product management, building balance sheet, debt collections, marketing, communication, training, etc. And I was fortunate to get opportunities to work with some of the most brilliant minds, many of whom are my mentors. And looking back, I think I would have just continued doing more of the same jobs. So in many ways, and if I can, borrow your word, which is a maverick moment of sorts for me, was when I asked myself that in all of this, what is it that I love the most? And I realized it was about working with people and igniting that human spark in them. Mm-hmm. And it was while working with the learning and development team, I realized that this was my calling. And two of my colleagues at work and I decided to come together to set up our own company, TBSL. We curate bespoke solutions for clients, helping them build internal capabilities. And our work is in the area of training that focuses on business storytelling, future human skills, behavior skill development, and developing high-performing teams, etc. And I'm also a trained executive life coach.
Okay, that's brilliant. That's quite in-depth. There's one thing that you said there that got me interested, which was business storytelling. So can you tell me about how can you drive business results through business storytelling?
Okay. So we know stories have an incredible natural power. And so the question is, how do you harness this power in a business setting? And it reminds me of this song, 4 Minutes, and you may have heard it. It's a collaboration between Madonna and Justin Timberlake, where Madonna wasn't very happy with the lyrics. She thought it wasn't punchy enough. It wasn't power-packed enough. And so she wanted to change the lyrics. And Justin told her, no, you can't change the world in 4 minutes. And while storytelling in business also can't be learned in 4 minutes, it's definitely a learnable future skills, very valuable both in one's personal and professional life. So to your question, how does a leader inspire, influence, and engage teams to get their message to stick? Now, in business storytelling, the objective is not for a leader to become a storyteller, a J.K. Rowling. Think about it. Who wants to be a storyteller unless you're working on stage? So our intervention focuses on stories as a tool to achieve specific business outcomes. Example, using the power of stories as a tool to drive innovation, craft, and communicate change, authentic leadership, breaking complex into simple and easy to understand messaging, etc. So in other words, stories is a medium for leaders to communicate with impact, engage, and influence. Instead of leaders being difficult to understand, inauthentic, boring, or hard to understand. So our program focuses on leaders being authentic, sharing real-time experiences, sub 2 to 3 minutes. That adds credibility to the executive who's sharing the story. In fact, there's also research which was done by Chip and Dan Heath, who are the authors of this book called Made to Stick, where they say that, you know, after a presentation, 63% of the attendees remember stories and only 5% remember data. So I remember listening to a podcast where they interviewed John Flint, who was retiring after a 30-year career with HSBC. And in this podcast, he says, you know, over these years, I must have covered millions and millions of PowerPoint slides at work. And no one remembers them. Along the way, I have also shared stories of success, failure, and people remember that. And people still recount those stories when they meet me. So as human beings, we are wired to think in narratives. We are sense-making animals. In fact, you know, there's also research which says that data goes to our head and helps to draw conclusions, while stories connect and engage and helps to drive decision-making and action.
Brilliant. Thank you. So there's a few things there that you said, and maverick leaders, I've always said, and I say this in my book, The Maverick Paradox, The Secret Power Behind Successful Leaders, that maverick leaders are very good at storytelling, and that's how they align. So they listen to what the corporate vision is or the mission, and they're able to translate that into a story that people can get behind. So I can totally understand about
that, and it's quite interesting because I think sometimes leaders provide a story without actually purposely drafting it. So, for example, something's happening in an organisation and the story the leader's telling is, I'm not interested in it, I don't agree with it, I think it's really bad. And you know, and what I mean is they'll say things like, yeah, the management, have, even though they're managers, the management have said we're doing X and, you know, there's nothing I can do about it, so we just need to, you know, roll up our sleeves and get on with it. And that in itself is a story designed for failure. Whereas, you know, with a little bit more honesty and a little bit more authenticity, then maybe people will be more aligned to making that change. So how does someone become more authentic?
So if I can just draw attention to something very interesting that you said about maverick leadership and being honest and authentic. So if I could just first draw attention to the fact that, you know, why are stories, why do stories matter in the workplace? Before I answer that, and there's primarily three reasons. The first one being the human reason, which is that as human beings, we are wired to tell stories from cave time. And the second reason is the socio-cultural reason, which is that research says that we see social media a minimum of 300 times in a day. We are in a content-rich environment. And in fact, this 300 numbers would probably have, you know, maybe doubled over COVID times. So, you know, and then, of course, there are 100 shows on Netflix, Amazon, etc. So we do have a problem of choice and plenty. There's information download. And in all of this, how does one cut through the noise and make an impact? Stories help in doing that. The third reason is an interesting one, which is stories conjure places, images, emotions, and link things together in a logical sequence. And that's what makes stories memorable. Now, the scientific reason is called neurocoupling. For example, there was an experiment which was conducted where a person was sharing a story and the other person was listening to that story. There was an MRI test of the brain being conducted in parallel for both of them. Now, what was noticed was as the person was sharing the story, parts of his brain were being lit up. And the listener's brain was mirroring exactly that. Now, here's where it gets interesting. A few seconds into the story, the listener's brain was being lit up even faster and ahead of the storyteller's brain. Because as a listener, there was anticipation and prediction. Okay, so what happened next? And then what happened? The listener was so engaged. Now imagine how powerful this can be in business as a leader when we are engaging with stakeholders.
So I wonder whether when you're designing your business story, you can design it in a way that makes neurocoupling more likely to happen. And if you do that, is that manipulative or influential? What do you think?
So, you know, I just want to actually share something. You know, these days we are talking about the fact that how difficult it is about connecting over Zoom. And we are talking about the fact that, you know, it's important to read the room. And how do you read the room even during, you know, right now over Zoom? So there was this interview which was conducted of Raghu Krishnamurthy, who was the ex-CHRO of GE, and he shared a very interesting example. And he talks about one of the managers there who was over Zoom having a meeting. And what she noticed was that one of the members seemed to be having a problem interacting with the team members. So, you know, every time the person had to be silent, that person would actually be interrupting people. And when the person had to respond, seemed to be missing the cues altogether. Now, this manager, you know, while of course she did ask, so, you know, what's the problem? But it wasn't just listening to the response. She was actually listening to the person with her heart and her eyes. So when she noticed this, she called him and said, you know, help me understand. You don't seem to be all there. What is it? How can I help you? And he then said that, you know, I am autistic and I was struggling to catch the cues. And she told him, that's okay. Let me think about it. Give me some time. She instituted a protocol the next time they were having a meeting. And she says that we're not going to say anything or interrupt. Every time you're going to be wanting to say something, just hold a pink slip. Or once you finish speaking, then you will all say Roger, like walkie-talkie. Mm-hmm. Now, people found that really odd. You know, why do we need to say Roger and why do we need to hold these pink slips, etc.? And then she explained to all of them saying that one of our colleagues here is finding it difficult. So we are introducing this so that no person is left behind. So as a manager, she listened with her heart, eyes, and provided that emotional first aid instead of just theorizing, saying that, okay, you know, it's important to, you know, be read the room and we need to be able to listen with our ears and all of that. She actually used that as an example to demonstrate how we need to be able to really live with authenticity and empathy at our workplace. So to your question, you know, Jude, that here in storytelling in business is not about made up fictional, it's about real time experiences. And I want to add that, you know, we've had experience where people have said, you know, I'm a very numbers person. I can't share stories. So what do I do? Now, we share that our program on business storytelling is not about make-believe, fairy tale, or any of that. It's about what we call the small S, or the little stories, little experiences and anecdote at the workplace. And all of us at work have innumerable stories on a daily basis. And this is what we are talking about in business storytelling.
Okay, thank you for that. What you didn't say, though, is whether you think it's manipulative or influential to actually craft a message to ensure that neurocoupling occurs.
Yeah, so when we're talking about neurocoupling, it's primarily about the connection that happens and the emotional connect which happens when we share stories. So it's really about being authentic and it's about building that connection. So if I can share, you know, a small anecdote here as well, which is where there was this lady who was in the financial sector called Carla Harris. And she was a choir singer. And she would never talk about it. In fact, she was, very, very strong with her numbers on being a powerful leader. And this one time she went for a meeting with one of her colleagues. And this colleague mentioned in the midst of a, discussion, saying that, you know, my colleague here was a choir singer. And immediately the entire conversation came to a halt. And suddenly there was a lot of discussion about her experience there. And, you know, the entire mood of the conversation suddenly just became so easy. Instead of a boring financial discussion, it just became so much more genuine, authentic, and real conversation where people were not talking at each other. People were actually talking to each other. And that's what happens when we are able to really build that heartfelt conversation, which could, and this is nothing against numbers, you know, we are not talking about business storytelling is all about, you know, using your creative brain. It's about even using data in a manner that is going to be able to connect with your audience, which is why we say stories are shared in a certain context. And it helps to bring that emotion. Now, when we talk about emotion, it's not about theory emotion. It just makes you feel a certain way. We say often that stories are facts wrapped in context and delivered with emotions.
Okay. Thank you for that. One of the things that you said that you do is help develop future human skills. Can you tell me what do you mean by future human skills? What skills are those?
Yeah. So, one of the future human skills is, of course, storytelling, because Forbes has defined storytelling as one of the 21st century future skills. The other program that we run specifically is the future human skills, where we are talking about the fact that as technology and digital is becoming a way of life, what's important is to keep the human at the heart and center of all conversation around digital transformation. So our work is about bringing in elements of agility. It's about being more collaborative at the workplace. It's about also finding your purpose at work. It's about developing that growth mindset, removing those unconscious biases that we have right now, which, you know, are somewhere hampering our progress and growth at the workplace. So how are we going to be able to equip people with all and some of those skills so that they're going to be able to ensure that as and when digital transformation takes over life, it does not take over the human ingenuity and creativity? Because at the end of the day, all digital transformation that's happening is led by people and for people. So it's just a means to a much larger objective. In fact, you know, it's like Alvin Toffler, a futurist who says it, I think, in the best possible way, where he says that the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read or write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. Mm. So that's really what future human skills is all about.
So it's the ability to continually learn.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which makes sense, because I remember reading some research a few years back now that said that Generation Z will probably have about 30 careers in their lifetime. Yeah. And I was like, do they mean 30 jobs or 30 careers? Because 30 careers is almost unbelievable, because that's a complete change of what you've done before, whereas 30 jobs may be in one or two different industries. But even so, even if it was 30 jobs, that's quite substantial. Okay, before we end our conversation today, can you tell us how does one go about crafting a business story?
Yeah. So you're absolutely right when you ask me this question, because storytelling in business is a structured process. it is very well defined, and it's also deliberate. So we start off with what's called a relevant statement, which is, why are you telling me this story? The second part of it is to actually share the story. And the third piece is, every story in a business context must have a business point, or, you know, what we call the takeaway.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the second part of it, which is the story, how should a story be narrated? It has four key elements, which is your time or place marker, a sequence of events, this happened, then that happened, etc. So it's like a causative equation, that two cannot happen without one, three cannot happen without one, and two, so on. And then you have the third piece, which is the characters. What makes a story really interesting is when you have characters. And what makes the character, that story really memorable, is when those characters have names and, you know, there's dialogues in first person between those characters. And finally, there is a reveal, which is something unexpected happened at the end of the story. Finally, like I said, it has to end with a business point. And if I can, you know, just share an example, because otherwise I would just be talking in the abstract, which is not business storytelling. So, so let me give you an example. Now, since we were talking about digital, digital technology has really transformed, especially the retail business. For example, in IKEA Dubai, they opened a new store which was very far off from the main part of the city. And as part of the opening promotion, they came up with a unique idea to woo customers to their new store, which was about using Google Maps. So using Google Maps, the company launched a program that allows shoppers at its new store to earn credit for the time they would spend driving to the store. So when a customer traveled to the new IKEA store, all he did was to go up to the reception, show their Google Map timeline to the store employee, and they would receive credit for that. For example, the first person who walked in has spent an hour-long trip to the store, and the person at the reception said, "Sir, you know, you have spent enough time on the road, which is worth a coffee table for you. Here's the voucher and you can get a coffee table." So the guy said, "Oh, you know, what if I had spent 2 hours trip?" So he said, "That would earn you a free bookshelf." So this was a great example of any time you can turn one of your biggest challenges into a win for your customer through a creative use of technology.
That's interesting. Did they do that just for the day opening, or is that their standard policy?
The first day. Yes.
I was going to say, I wonder what people would have said the second time they turned up and were like, "Where's my bookcase?" That would be quite amusing.
Hopefully they've got... Yeah, hopefully they've got enough customers now and they don't need to do this. And probably they have new ideas now.
That is definitely innovative. So thank you for that. Thank you for coming onto the show. Would you come back another day?
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. I had a wonderful conversation. And I love the questions. And you are running a fantastic podcast, which is so well regarded, so well respected. It's one of the top podcast now. So congratulations to you, Jude.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you once again for tuning in to the Maverick Paradox podcast. I hope you have enjoyed listening to my conversation with Aruna Delhi as much as I enjoyed having it. At the Maverick Paradox, we improve your impact and influence by enabling you to effectively strategize, innovate, and execute. To find out more, contact us at judith@maverickparadox.com. Thank you. Well, that's us done.
Maverick Paradox supports organizations to enhance their leadership capability and business owners to develop and grow their business. An international thought leader and radio host, founder Judith Germain,
specializes in maverick leadership and enabling individuals, business owners, and organizations to improve their impact and influence. Judith is a business mentor and Chartered Fellow of the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development, with over 20 years senior strategic and operational experience in HR. Find out more about her services, books, and platforms at maverickparadox.co.uk.
Welcome to the Maverick Paradox podcast, where we explore what it is to be a maverick and discover effective modes of leadership. I am Judith Germain, and my mission is to propel the maverick mindset into a world where character and integrity will ultimately have a higher premium than personality and bureaucracy. So thank you for joining me on this journey. If you would like to continue with me, then please subscribe to my podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, or one of the other popular podcast platforms.
And today, our guest is Aruna Jelly Maria. Hiya, how are you doing?
Hi, Ju. Thank you for inviting me. Very excited about our conversation today.
Thank you. Yes, I'm looking forward to it too. So before we begin, though, who are you?
Jude, I'm originally from India, and for the last 8 years, I have been living in Hong Kong. That's home now. I see myself as a jack of many trades, or should I say Jacqueline. I grew up in a typical hardworking, loving middle-class family, and we would be transferred frequently across India. As you may know, in India, Jude, no two straits speak the same language, eat the same food, and culturally are very distinct from each other. I have changed over 10 schools, and I would love that. The excitement was around making new friends from diverse backgrounds. And thank you for asking me this, because, you know, as I am reflecting, why am I so excited to meet different clients across different geographies? I think this would have been perhaps where it is rooted. Also, because both my parents were working, my mother's a doctor, dad sold typewriters. Every summer break, I would indulge myself in something new and exciting to learn. So one holiday, it would be painting, next would be sewing, baking, typing, photography, etc. And till date, I'm always in this, I think, learning mode, if I can use that. And that's a phase of life that excites me most, exploring, learning. And again, I think, you know, as an entrepreneur in this phase of my life, it really serves me well, running a learning consulting company. On the professional side, I started working for a multinational bank, engaged in different roles, product management, building balance sheet, debt collections, marketing, communication, training, etc. And I was fortunate to get opportunities to work with some of the most brilliant minds, many of whom my mentors. And looking back, I think I would have just continued doing more of the same jobs. So in many ways, and if I can, borrow your word, which is a maverick moment of sorts for me, was when I asked myself that in all of this, what is it that I love the most? And I realized it was about working with people and igniting that human spark in them. Mm-hmm. And it was while working with the learning and development team, I realized that this was my calling. And two of my colleagues at work and I decided to come together to set up our own company, TBSL. We curate bespoke solutions for clients, helping them build internal capabilities. And our work is in the area of training that focuses on business storytelling, future human skills, behavior skill development, and developing high-performing teams, etc. And I'm also a trained executive life coach.
That's brilliant. That's quite in-depth. There's one thing that you said there that got me interested, which was business storytelling. So can you tell me about how can you drive business results through business storytelling?
Okay. So we know stories have an incredible natural power. And so the question is, how do you harness this power in a business setting? And it reminds me of this song, 4 Minutes, and you may have heard it. It's a collaboration between Madonna and Justin Timberlake, where Madonna wasn't very happy with the lyrics. She thought it wasn't punchy enough. It wasn't power-packed enough. And so she wanted to change the lyrics. And Justin told her, no, you can't change the world in 4 minutes. And while storytelling in business also can't be learned in 4 minutes, it's definitely a learnable future skills, very valuable both in one's personal and professional life. So to your question, how does a leader inspire, influence, and engage teams to get their message to stick? Now, in business storytelling, the objective is not for a leader to become a storyteller, a J.K. Rowling. Think about it. Who wants to be a storyteller unless you're working on stage? So our intervention focuses on stories as a tool to achieve specific business outcomes. Example, using the power of stories as a tool to drive innovation, craft, and communicate change, authentic leadership, breaking complex into simple and easy to understand messaging, etc. So in other words, stories is a medium for leaders to communicate with impact, engage, and influence. Instead of leaders being difficult to understand, inauthentic, boring, or hard to understand. So our program focuses on leaders being authentic, sharing real-time experiences, sub 2 to 3 minutes. That adds credibility to the executive who's sharing the story. In fact, there's also research which was done by Chip and Dan Heath, who are the authors of this book called Made to Stick, where they say that, you know, after a presentation, 63% of the attendees remember stories and only 5% remember data. So I remember listening to a podcast where they interviewed John Flint, who was retiring after a 30-year career with HSBC. And in this podcast, he says, you know, over these years, I must have covered millions and millions of PowerPoint slides at work. And no one remembers them. Along the way, I have also shared stories of success, failure, and people remember that. And people still recount those stories when they meet me. So as human beings, we are wired to think in narratives. We are sense-making animals. In fact, you know, there's also research which says that data goes to our head and helps to draw conclusions, while stories connect and engage and helps to drive decision-making and action.
Brilliant. Thank you. So there's a few things there that you said, and Maverick leaders, I've always said, and I say this in my book, The Maverick Paradox, The Secret Power Behind Successful Leaders, that Maverick leaders are very good at storytelling, and that's how they align. So they listen to what the corporate vision is or the mission, and they're able to translate that into a story that people can get behind. So I can totally understand about that, and it's quite interesting because I think sometimes leaders provide a story without actually purposely drafting it. So for example, something's happening in an organization and the story the leader is telling is, I'm not interested in it, I don't agree with it, I think it's really bad, and you know, and what I mean is they'll say things like, yeah, the management have, even though they're managers, the management have said we're doing X and, you know, there's nothing I can do about it, so we just need to, you know, roll up our sleeves and get on with it. And that in itself is a story designed for failure. Whereas, you know, with a little bit more honesty and a little bit more authenticity, then maybe people will be more aligned to making that change. So how does someone become more authentic?
Yeah. So if I can just draw attention to something very interesting that you said about maverick leadership and being honest and authentic. Mm-hmm. So if I could just first draw attention to the fact that, you know, why do stories matter in the workplace? Before I answer that, and there's primarily three reasons. The first one being the human reason, which is that as human beings, we are wired to tell stories from cave time. And the second reason is the socio-cultural reason, which is that research says that we see social media a minimum of 300 times in a day. We are in a content-rich environment. And in fact, this 300 numbers would probably have, you know, maybe doubled over COVID times. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and then, of course, there are 100 shows on Netflix, Amazon, etc. So we do have a problem of choice and plenty. There's information download. And in all of this, how does one cut through the noise and make an impact? Stories help in doing that. The third reason is an interesting one, which is stories conjure places, images, emotions, and link things together in a logical sequence. And that's what makes stories memorable. Now, the scientific reason is called neurocoupling. For example, there was an experiment which was conducted where a person was sharing a story and the other person was listening to that story. There was an MRI test of the brain being conducted in parallel for both of them. Now, what was noticed was as the person was sharing the story, parts of his brain were being lit up. And the listener's brain was mirroring exactly that. Now, here's where it gets interesting. A few seconds into the story, the listener's brain was being lit up even faster and ahead of the storyteller's brain. Because as a listener, there was anticipation and prediction. Okay, so what happened next? And then what happened? The listener was so engaged. Now imagine how powerful this can be in business as a leader when we are engaging with stakeholders.
So I wonder whether when you're designing your business story, you can design it in a way that makes neurocoupling more likely to happen. And if you do that, is that manipulative or influential? What do you think?
Yeah. So, you know, I just want to actually share something. You know, these days we are talking about the fact that how difficult it is about connecting over Zoom. And we are talking about the fact that, you know, it's important to read the room. And how do you read the room even during, you know, right now over Zoom? So there was this interview which was conducted of Raghu Krishnamurthy, who was the ex-CHRO of GE, and he shared a very interesting example. And he talks about one of the managers there who was over Zoom having a meeting. And what she noticed was that one of the members seemed to be having a problem interacting with the team members. So, you know, every time the person had to be silent, that person would actually be interrupting people. And when the person had to respond, seemed to be missing the cues altogether. Now, this manager, you know, while of course she did ask, so, you know, what's the problem? But it wasn't just listening to the response. She was actually listening to the person with her heart and her eyes. So when she noticed this, she called him and said, you know, help me understand. You don't seem to be all there. What is it? How can I help you? And he then said that, you know, I am autistic and I was struggling to catch the cues. And she told him, that's okay. Let me think about it. Give me some time. She instituted a protocol the next time they were having a meeting. And she says that we're not going to say anything or interrupt. Every time you're going to be wanting to say something, just hold a pink slip. Or once you finish speaking, then you will all say Roger, like walkie-talkie. Mm-hmm. Now, people found that really odd. You know, why do we need to say Roger and why do we need to hold these pink slips, etc.? And then she explained to all of them saying that one of our colleagues here is finding it difficult. So we are introducing this so that no person is left behind. So as a manager, she listened with her heart, eyes, and provided that emotional first aid instead of just theorizing, saying that, okay, you know, it's important to, you know, be read the room and we need to be able to listen with our ears and all of that. She actually used that as an example to demonstrate how we need to be able to really live with authenticity and empathy at our workplace. So to your question, you know, Jude, that here in storytelling in business is not about made up, fictional, it's about real time experiences. And I want to add that, you know, we've had experience where people have said, you know, I'm a very numbers person. I can't share stories. So what do I do? Now, we share that our program on business storytelling is not about make-believe, fairy tale, or any of that. It's about what we call the small S, or the little stories, little experiences and anecdote at the workplace. And all of us at work have innumerable stories on a daily basis. And this is what we are talking about in business storytelling.
Okay, thank you for that. What you didn't say, though, is whether you think it's manipulative or influential to actually craft a message to ensure that neurocoupling occurs.
Yeah, so when we're talking about neurocoupling, it's primarily about the connection that happens and the emotional connect which happens when we share stories. So it's really about being authentic, and it's about building that connection. So if I can share, you know, a small anecdote here as well, which is where there was this lady who was in the financial sector called Carla Harris. And she was a choir singer. And she would never talk about it. In fact, she was, very, very strong with her numbers on being a powerful leader. And this one time she went for a meeting with one of her colleagues. And this colleague mentioned in the midst of a, discussion, saying that, you know, my colleague here was a choir singer. And immediately the entire conversation came to a halt. And suddenly there was a lot of discussion about her experience there. And, you know, the entire mood of the conversation suddenly just became so easy. Instead of a boring financial discussion, it just became so much more genuine, authentic, and real conversation where people were not talking at each other. People were actually talking to each other. And that's what happens when we are able to really build that heartfelt conversation, which could, and this is nothing against numbers, you know, we are not talking about business storytelling is all about, using your creative brain. It's about even using data in a manner that is going to be able to connect with your audience, which is why we say stories are shared in a certain context. And it helps to bring that emotion. Now, when we talk about emotion, it's not about teary emotion. It just makes you feel a certain way. We say often that stories are facts wrapped in context and delivered with emotions.
Okay. Thank you for that. One of the things that you said that you do is help develop future human skills. Can you tell me what do you mean by future human skills? What skills are those?
Yeah. So, one of the future human skills is, of course, storytelling, because Forbes has defined storytelling as one of the 21st century future skills. The other program that we run specifically is the future human skills, where we are talking about the fact that as technology and digital is becoming a way of life, what's important is to keep the human at the heart and center of all conversation around digital transformation. So our work is about bringing in elements of agility. It's about being more collaborative at the workplace. It's about also finding your purpose at work. It's about developing that growth mindset, removing those unconscious biases that we have right now, which, are somewhere hampering our progress and growth at the workplace. So how are we going to be able to equip people with all and some of those skills so that they're going to be able to ensure that as and when digital transformation takes over life, it does not take over the human ingenuity and creativity? Because at the end of the day, all digital transformation that's happening is led by people and for people. So it's just a means to a much larger objective. In fact, it's like Alvin Toffler, a futurist who says it, I think, in the best possible way, where he says that the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read or write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. So that's really what future human skills is all about.
So it's the ability to continually learn.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which makes sense, because I remember reading some research a few years back now that said that Generation Z will probably have about 30 careers in their lifetime.
Yeah.
And I was like, do they mean 30 jobs or 30 careers? Because 30 careers is almost unbelievable, because that's a complete change of what you've done before, whereas 30 jobs may be in one or two different industries. But even so, even if it was 30 jobs, that's quite substantial. Okay, before we end our conversation today, can you tell us how does one go about crafting a business story?
So you're absolutely right when you ask me this question, because storytelling in business is a structured process. It's very well defined, and it's also deliberate. So we start off with what's called a relevant statement, which is, why are you telling me this story? The second part of it is to actually share the story. And the third piece is, every story in a business context must have a business point, or what we call the takeaway.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the second part of it, which is the story, how should a story be narrated? It has four key elements, which is your time or place marker, a sequence of events, this happened, then that happened, etc. So it's like a causative equation. that two cannot happen without one, three cannot happen without one, and two, so on. And then you have the third piece, which is the characters. What makes a story really interesting is when you have characters. And what makes the character, that story really memorable, is when those characters have names and, you know, there's dialogues in first person between those characters. And finally, there is a reveal, which is something unexpected happened at the end of the story. Finally, like I said, it has to end with a business point. And if I can, you know, just share an example, because otherwise I would just be talking in the abstract, which is not business storytelling. So, so let me give you an example. Now, since we were talking about digital, digital technology has really transformed, especially the retail business. For example, in IKEA Dubai, they opened a new store which was very far off from the main part of the city. And as part of the opening promotion, they came up with a unique idea to woo customers to their new store, which was about using Google Maps. So using Google Maps, the company launched a program that allows shoppers at its new store to earn credit for the time they would spend driving to the store. So when a customer traveled to the new IKEA store, all he did was to go up to the reception, show their Google Map timeline to the store employee, and they would receive credit for that. For example, the first person who walked in has spent an hour-long trip to the store. And the person at the reception said, "Sir, you know, you have spent enough time on the road, which is worth a coffee table for you. Here's the voucher and you can get a coffee table." So the guy said, "Oh, you know, what if I had spent 2 hours trip?" So he said, "That would earn you a free bookshelf." So this was a great example of anytime you can turn one of your biggest challenges into a win for your customer through a creative use of technology.
That's interesting. Did they do that just for the day opening, or is that their standard policy?
The first day, yes.
I was going to say, I wonder what people would have said the second time they turned up and was like, "Where's my bookcase?" That would be quite
hopefully
amusing.
Hopefully they've got enough customers now and they don't need to do this. And probably they have new ideas now.
That is definitely innovative. So thank you for that. Thank you for coming onto the show. Would you come back another day?
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. I had a wonderful conversation. And I love the questions. And you are running a fantastic podcast, which is so well regarded, so well respected. It's one of the top podcasts now. So congratulations to you, Jude.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you once again for tuning in to the Maverick Paradox podcast. I hope you have enjoyed listening to my conversation with Aruna Delhi as much as I enjoyed having it. At the Maverick Paradox, we improve your impact and influence by enabling you to effectively strategize, innovate, and execute. To find out more, contact us at judith@maverickparadox.com. Thank you.
The Maverick Paradox. Judith Germain is an author, speaker, consultant, mentor, and trainer, and the leading authority on Maverick leadership. She is the founder of The Maverick Paradox, which supports organizations to enhance their leadership capabilities and to help business owners develop and grow their businesses. Judith enables individuals, business owners, and organizations to improve their impact and influence. She is also HR Zone's leadership columnist, an international online radio host, and her expert opinion has appeared in national, international, and trade press.